How the French Won Waterloo, or Think They Did, by Stephen Clarke, read by Justin Edwards. L'histoire est une suite de mensonges sur lesquels on est d'accord. History is a series of lies about which we agree. Napoleon Bonaparte. Everyone knows who lost the Battle of Waterloo. It was Napoleon Bonaparte, Emperor of France. Even the French have to admit that on the evening of 18th of June, 1815, it was the Corsican with one hand in his waistcoat who fled the battlefield, his Grande Armée in tatters, and his reign effectively at a humiliating end. Napoleon had gambled everything on one great confrontation with his enemies, and he had lost. The word lost, in this case having its usual meaning of not won, been defeated, trounced, hammered, etc. No one seriously disputes this historical fact. Well, almost no one. Let's look at a few quotations. This defeat shines with the aura of victory, writes France's former Prime Minister Dominique de Villepin in a recent book about Napoleon. For the English, Waterloo was a defeat that they won, claims French historian Jean-Claude Damam in his study of the battle, published in 1999. A 19th century French poet called Édouard d'Escolar preempted this modern doublethink in a poem about Waterloo, prefacing it with a quotation to the effect that defeats are only victories to which fortune has refused to give wings. Astonishingly, it is obvious that in some French eyes, where Napoleon is concerned, losing can actually mean winning, or at least not really losing. This despite the fact that after the Battle of Waterloo, Napoleon was ousted from power, forced to flee his country, and then banished into exile on a wind-blown British island for the rest of his life. The only victory parades in France in the summer of 1815 were those by British, Prussian, Austrian and Russian troops as they marched along the Champs-Élysées past Napoleon's half-built and rather prematurely named Arc de Triomphe. And yet today, visitors to Waterloo, just south of Brussels, might be forgiven for thinking that the result of the battle had been overturned after a steward's inquiry and victory handed to the losers. The most spectacular memorial there is the Panorama, a circular building that houses a dramatic 110-metre-long painting of the battle at its height. It is a wonderful picture. You can almost hear the sabres rattling, the cannons firing, the horses snorting, the roars and screams of the fighting men. But there is something very strange about it. Napoleon is in the distance, calmly watching the action, while Wellington seems to be trapped in a corner by a thundering cavalry charge in imminent danger of having his famous hooked nose hacked off by a French blade. Can this really be the painting that is meant to serve as an official memorial of the battle? The answer is yes, or rather oui, because the painter, Louis Dumoulin, was a Parisian bought in by the Belgians just over 100 years ago to commemorate the centenary of the most famous historical event that ever took place in their country, apart perhaps from the invention of the waffle. This French cavalry charge was the image Dumoulin selected as being representative of the battle as a whole. Napoleon himself could not have chosen a more Bonapartist scene, and yet it was approved by the Belgians. Needless to say, Waterloo is in Wallonie, the French-speaking half of Belgium, where Napoleon has always been hailed as a liberating hero. Similarly, in the old Waterloo Museum next to the Panorama, visitors hoping to watch a French-made film about the battle enter the video room beneath a portrait of a defiant-looking general. No, not one of the victors. It's Napoleon again. A huge new museum is currently being built at Waterloo in readiness for the bicentenary. It will probably give a more balanced and historically accurate view of the battle. But one thing seems certain. The new gift shop will be just like the old one. That is, selling 10 times more souvenir statuettes, medals and portraits of Napoleon than of anyone else involved in the battle. French revisionists seem to have taken possession of Waterloo, and Napoleon's image is everywhere. He's been turned into the icon that represents the events of 18th of June, 1815. He lost, but that doesn't seem to matter. It's a beautifully French contradiction that provokes two main questions. Who exactly is behind this rewriting of history that has been going on ever since the battle ended? And why do they feel the need to indulge in such outrageous denial? Luckily for me, and I hope for you, dear listener, the answers are fascinatingly complex. But let me give a brief introductory summary before going into much more detail in the book. First of all, Napoleon has an army of fiercely loyal fans. They've been around since he was Emperor of France, and they are as fanatical today as they ever were. These are the people who dress up in Napoleonic uniform and shout, "Vive l'Empereur!" at battle reenactments, who give generous grants to Napoleonic research as long as the thesis flatters Napoleon, and who paid 1.8 million euros for one of his famous black hats when it came up for auction in November 2014. Among these fans is a belligerent battalion of French historians who refuse to associate Napoleon's name with anything as shameful as defeat. To achieve this feat of historical acrobatics, they will use any argument they can muster. At Waterloo, they contend, Napoleon might have lost to Blücher, but he beat Wellington. The British cheated by choosing the battlefield. Napoleon's generals disobeyed him. Traitors revealed his plans. The French government prevented him from mustering another army and fighting on, etc., etc. Anything to have Napoleon emerge as a winner of some sort. In any case, these fan historians constantly remind us, Napoleon was France's greatest ever champion. He won far more battles than he lost, and during his short reign, France was at the peak of its influence in the world, with most of continental Europe under the Napoleonic yoke. To these determined and highly outspoken Bonapartists, Waterloo is nothing more than a minor blemish on Napoleon's glorious record. And, in a way, the whole of modern French history revolves around, or has its roots in, Napoleon. Even historians who see him as a dictator and are relieved that his imperial regime was toppled will readily acknowledge Napoleon's greatness and the undeniable influence he exerts on present-day life in France. After all, most of the laws he drafted are still in place, minus a few of his more sexist clauses. He invented France's education system, and all modern French presidents model themselves on his autocratic style of leadership. They even live and work in his former palace, surrounded by his furniture. Which brings us to the question of why exactly all these people are in denial about Waterloo, the battle that, like it or not, ended Napoleon's political and military career. Is it a classic emotional blockage, patriotism gone mad, or is there something even more subtly French at play? Well, yes to all those rhetorical questions, but the central reason seems to be that ever since 1815, it has been vital for the French national psyche to see Napoleon as a winner. If he is a loser, so is France. And if there is one thing the French as a nation hate, it is losing, especially to les Anglais. This is why even those French people who acknowledge at least partial defeat at Waterloo are determined to extract some form of triumph from the debacle. They will say that the outnumbered French troops were defending the nobler cause, that their glorious defiance made them the tragic heroes of the day, and so on. There is no end to the evasive action they will take. To illustrate all this historical escapology, I've concentrated mainly on French sources. Waterloo veterans, 19th century French novelists and poets who experienced Napoleon's regime, French historians writing from 1815 right up to today, and of course, Napoleon himself, who had time while in exile to relive and rewrite every second of the battle. Exploring their original words and impressions has given me a vivid insight into what the French have been saying about their beloved empereur for the last two centuries, and what they're still doing to defend his iconic image. English language commentators seem to spend a lot of time reworking the old argument that Waterloo was purely and simply a hard-won Anglo-Prussian victory that got rid of Napoleon and changed the course of European history. But Napoleon's admirers, past and present, show that the Battle of Waterloo and its 200-year-long aftermath have been a lot more complicated and a lot more French than that. Stephen Clarke, Paris, February 2015. Part 1. Chapter 1. Napoleon was a peace lover. La paix est le vœu de mon cœur, mais la guerre n'a jamais été contraire à ma gloire. My heart wishes for peace, but war has never diminished my glory. Napoleon Bonaparte in a letter to England's King George III in 1805. 1. First, the context. Why exactly did Napoleon Bonaparte confront the Duke of Wellington and Prussia's General Field Marshal Gebhard Blücher at a crossroads in Belgium on that rainy day of 18th of June 1815, aside from the fact that Belgium was conveniently central for all three? The main reason is, of course, that Britain and France had been at war virtually non-stop since 1337. The Napoleonic Wars were more or less a continuation of the medieval Hundred Years' War, and in 1815 things had come to an ugly head. As the 19th century French historian Jules Michelet, author of a 19-volume Histoire de France, puts it, the war of wars, the combat of combats, is England against France. All the rest are mere episodes. French Bonapartists insist that Napoleon didn't want war with Britain. Napoleon himself said so. He was a peace-loving man, much more interested in modernising his own country than firing cannons at his neighbours. All he wanted to do was write new laws, create new schools, and turn beetroot into sugar, all of which he actually did, as we shall see in a later chapter.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.